Okay, we're live on YouTube now. Good afternoon and welcome to the first session of the NUJS online lecture series hosted by the Student Juridical Association 2019-20. This session was envisioned to ensure students have ample opportunity to learn even amidst the pandemic, and we hope to provide many more such opportunities this week and in the weeks to come. Our first session kicks off with a very special guest, the additional Solicitor General of India, Ms. Pinky Anand, would be speaking on the invocation of force majeure in times of COVID, a topic that is extremely relevant in this day and age. The session would be moderated by Professor Dr. Lovely Dasgupta, Associate Professor at NUJS Kolkata. We'd like to thank both guests for agreeing to do this. And without further ado, I'd like to hand over the mic to Dr. Dasgupta to introduce our guest speaker.
Thank you, Aishi. Ma'am, very warm welcome in these times. We are having a very new experience of hosting webinar, and it would have been really nice if we could have had a face-to-face interaction with you, with all our students and all our guests. It's my privilege, dear audience and dear viewers, to introduce to you Additional Solicitor General and Senior Advocate Pinky Anand. She needs no introduction. She is quite a renowned personality and a distinguished lawyer. She has got her well-established experience in different diverse areas of practice like family law, corporate law, international law, constitutional law, and the list keeps on, you know, going long and long and long, unending list of her achievements. There are hardly any words to cover her achievements. She has got her LLB degree from the Faculty of Law, University of Delhi, and did her master's at Harvard University with a prestigious INLAC scholarship. The most important part from a gender perspective is that she's broken many a glass ceilings. She's a pioneer. She's a role model for many of us because she was the first woman secretary elected to the Delhi University Students Union in 1980. And in 2014, she became the only second woman lawyer to be appointed as the Additional Solicitor General of India. She was the vice president of the Bar Association of India, and she has represented many in, you know, she has represented many a landmark cases. And you know, I can keep on going about her, but we are short of time. I just want to mention one thing, that she has, apart from being a lawyer, she's also a distinguished author, and she has published the seminal book. She's co-authored the International Family Law Jurisdiction Comparisons, published by Sweet and Maxwell, as well as she's published a recent book on Trials of Truth, India's Landmark Criminal Cases. Her motto in life, which we are all, you know, inspired by, is that she is a first generation lawyer. That's something which we need to learn a lot about. But she believes that confidence, determination, support from loved ones really helps one to establish and achieve their dreams. Without much ado, please, ma'am, I hand it over to you. We want to hear you out on force majeure in times of COVID-19.
Thank you so much, Lovely. I'm glad to be part of the NUJS series, and it's a privilege to have the campus law center, as I say always, but I'm sorry, the law center in NUJS to be organizing this entire process. As you know, that this is a new world. COVID-19 has made us realize that we can't really sit back and wait for the world to kind of come together. We have to keep the world going, waiting for a better day to dawn. In the meantime, I think the greatest challenge has been that of technology. All of you, I'm not saying Lovely you, but maybe Ayushi and all the other audience people, are first generation, digital generation. Yeah. We all are second generation. But I must say that I've been fighting to kind of get alert. I anyway love technology, to be honest, and I love experimenting. So today's experience was one, because my Mac was something that my secretary said, don't utilize this for the conference, because we've been told to use a laptop. But I said, no, I'm going to try to use the Mac itself, and of course, some minor processes. But having said this, I must also tell you, Lovely, before we go on to the subject in hand, and Ayushi, there are a couple of programs that are coming our way from the government. And I did suggest that I would get in touch with the NUJS to be able to have the students partake of it so that some exercise could be done towards the improvement of technologies and other issues, because today the virtual courts are functioning. In fact, I published an article on virtual codes yesterday, which came on the Daily Garden, but maybe you could have a look at that. But I think it's very exciting because I love to do work with students and with universities. I think institutional places are the best. Of course, my daughter's in fact studying at Georgetown, by the way, George Washington. And she has done her course through online, and she's been grumbling about it because the main agitation being you require the experience. But there's something to be said for actual experience as opposed to virtual experience. But having said all these preliminary statements on virtual world and whatever else, let's come to COVID-19 and force majeure. First of all, Lovely is a professor, so I feel awed by that situation. But with that point in hand, let's go forward. As a matter of course, I think it's COVID-19 has brought forth many, many issues now. For example, some of the issues which have been concerning are the main concerns of how it has affected, for example, PIS. That's been one domain. Second domain has been the issue of workers, migrant workers, which has come up. Third issue has been of health workers. Fourth issue has been, for example, of payment of salaries and wages to people, and no work, no pay. That is also, by the way, possibly one feature of force majeure, which would be dealt with in one way or the other. Right now, it is not specifically being urged, but largely it comes under force majeure as a concept. So you have these various diverse issues that are coming up in the courts. And in fact, yesterday when we were discussing, we were also talking about, while we are discussing the subject of how to get the law clear and lucid so that it could be dealt with in that category. And that to that extent, payment of rent, payment of salary, payment of wages is something which would squarely come within force majeure at COVID-19. Now, just to go back very briefly, there is a long history of force majeure and the law has been settled under the Contract Act, but nonetheless, it is something that is talked about and it comes as act of God, vis major, and various categories that it does come to. But it comes literally, in fact, force majeure comes from a French word, a superior force. Of course, today it is not superior force, but intervening force or a circumstance that has occurred subsequently. If you broadly take Section 32, and Section 56 of the Contract Act. That is actually what encapsulates the overall concept of force majeure. The difference between 32 and 56 possibly is well known, but in any case, Section 32 deals with a provision in the contract, and Section 56 is dehors the contract, it's outside the contract. So this is the essential difference, and I think to that extent, we have some variations from English law and others from where we have derived ourselves. Contract Act is 1872. We have derived ourselves, but Section 32 itself contemplates where the clause within the contract provides for certain events. The traditional ones are acts of war, earthquakes, floods, strikes, riots, broadly in this category. And very often, of course, there's an overarching kind of principle to say any other event not contemplated, which is also something which is going to be discussed in today's time because it has become material whether two things, act of God can be considered, or a pandemic can be considered to be an act of God. And the second feature of even the general clause, whether it would contemplate a situation of a pandemic, these are the issues that are going to be coming up. I'm not dealing with specific issues which are already been dealt with. That is quite clear from the judges and the various laws laid down. I'm talking about what is going to be coming up. So we could work on these concepts to see how to develop them forward and to see how it has been. Just as a matter of course, I would like to point out when we are talking on this act of God. Now, does an epidemic or pandemic constitute an act of God? There's no Indian law on the subject, by the way. Students feel free to, in fact, interact on this level and to see what you can develop. But there is a US and UK law. I mean, there's both these laws actually defined, and there they have been. So I'll just mention two, three of those judgments for your reference. In the Supreme Court, the Divisional Controller of KSRTC versus Mahadev Shetty, which held that the expression act of God signifies the operation of natural forces free from human intervention, with the caveat that every unexpected natural event does not operate as an excuse from liability if there is a reasonable possibility of their happening. There are similar judgments of Madras High Court and the Kerala High Court. This is on the Indian part, which doesn't deal with epidemics specifically, but act of God. On the part of act of God, including pandemic and epidemic, in Lakeman versus Pollard, where a laborer at a mill left his job early during a cholera epidemic due to concerns of contracting the disease and therefore failed to complete his work contract. In an action by the mill owners seeking compensation for work done by the laborer, it was argued that the work contract had been breached. The Supreme Court of Maine, USA, held that the cholera outbreak was an act of God, and the laborer was thus not in breach of the contract, since duty to perform under the contract was discharged. A similar situation was there in Coombs versus Nolan, where the district court for the Southern District of New York excused a delay in the discharge of a cargo, where the defendant could not obtain enough horses to unload a ship on time due to a then prevailing horse flu pandemic on the ground. The horse flu pandemic fell within the ambit of act of God. In Sandry versus Brooklyn, where the Supreme Court of North Dakota considered the case of school bus drivers for their wages under their transportation contracts during the period that the schools were shut due to the influenza outbreak. The Supreme Court of North Dakota discharged the school district from paying the bus drivers during the period that the schools were shut due to the influenza epidemic. The reasoning was based on the fact that the contract had become impossible to perform due to the shutdown. So this is where the US and the UK laws themselves have dealt with the subject of pandemics and epidemics and consequential issues on force majeure and the consequences arising from there. Coming back to the Indian, as I mentioned, broadly, there is nothing directly. Act of God has been construed in the three judgments that I mentioned to you. One of the Supreme Court, one of Kerala, and one of Madras High Court, which you could look up. But I would like to now just come back to the broad laws. There are about four judgments which are outstanding, which are all leading up to the last seminal judgment of Justice Nariman of the Supreme Court in energy watchdog, which I think kind of lays down the law precisely as to what it is. But if you just go back to a review over the three or four judgments that I mentioned, the first standing judgment on this is Satyabrata Ghosh versus Mughira Bangar, where in fact, both dealt with this issue. I would like to basically tell you the brief facts of the case, because I think it is always important to take that into consideration and to mention, in fact, an anomaly which occurred while we were talking. The defendant company owned a large tract of land, which is divided into several plots, and offers are invited from those interested in purchasing the plot. Small amount of money was connected as usual by earnest money at the time of agreement, deciding that the remaining amount would be paid once construction of roads and drains was done. In the middle, the collector passed an order of requisition for military purposes. Now, the act of requisition by its very nature is temporary. It's an interregnum situation. The company accordingly informed purchasers that due to the requisitioning, they wanted to cancel the agreement. But in fact, the Supreme Court held that it could not be canceled because the fundamental basis upon which the agreement rested was not affected. And that, just let me read out to you what the Supreme Court holds in that circumstance. What was held was the word impossible has not been used in the section in the sense of physical or literal impossibility. The performance of an act may not be literally impossible, but it may be impracticable and useless from the point of view of the object and purpose of the parties. If an untoward event or change of circumstance totally upsets the very foundation upon which the parties entered their agreement, it can be said that the promisor finds it impossible to do the act which he had promised to do so. It was further held that where the court finds that the contract itself either impliedly or expressly contains a term according to which the performance would stand discharged under certain circumstances, the dissolution of the contract would take place under the terms of the contract itself, and such cases would be dealt with under Section 32 of the Act. If, however, frustration is to take place towards the contract, it will be governed by Section 56. So that's what I mentioned to you at the outset, that you have two provisions, Section 32 and Section 56, one within the contract and a contemplation within the contract as to what to do. And that is not complete frustration. That is basically the consequences of force majeure, to say if an event happens which is contemplated, there might be deferral, there might be delay, there might be change of price. So each of these situations is contemplated within the provisions of the contract. Section 56 traditionally comes in post-contract, post not contemplated, and possibly what is impossible of performance, and where the fundamental contract itself changes. And I will come to the language of energy watchdog, which today stands as the seminal judgment on the point of at issue. After Satyabrata Ghosh, we have Alopi Prasad. Now that itself was in its own way fairly simple, but what that deals with is a claim for a higher price on account of change of circumstances, which of course was repelled by the Supreme Court. In particular, the plaintiffs were to supply ghee for the army personnel for consideration as stipulated under the contract. World War II happened, and you could always equate World War II to situations of pandemic, I suppose. Then started, and the plaintiffs demanded sale consideration of goods enhancement in view of the onerous discharge of their obligations, followed by the assurance of the government that it might be entertained. The plaintiffs continued the supply, but the assurance was never acted upon. There, the Supreme Court held that the Act does not enable a party to a contract to ignore the express covenants thereof and to claim payment for consideration for performance of the contracts at rates different from the stipulated rate. So, therefore, the question of no higher rates as contemplated in the contract, purely on the ground of equity. Parties to an executable contract are often faced in the course of carrying it out with a turn of events which they did not at all anticipate. For example, a wholly abnormal rise or fall in prices, which is an unexpected obstacle to execution. This does not get rid of the bargain that is made by the party. It is only when a consideration of the terms of the contract in the light of the circumstances existing when it was made showed that they never agreed to be bound in a fundamentally different situation which had unexpectedly emerged that the contract ceases to bind. It is further held that the performance of a contract is never discharged merely because it has become onerous to one of the parties. Now, this is the broad guidelines that have been laid down by the Supreme Court and from time to time reiterated. Just as a matter of course, an English judgment, Sakir Loglu versus Nobdi Thol, where the Suez Canal had closed, it was held that alternative routes were possible for the supply of groundnuts. And even though it was three times as much, it wasn't a fundamental alteration of the contract and therefore not a force majeure. Similar views have, of course, been expounded by Chitty on contracts and Trital on frustration and force majeure, where you hold that alternate modes do not basically make the contract cease to exist, and a rise in prices itself is not a ground to say that the contract can't be performed. The two recent cases that have come as far as England is concerned and India is concerned, as I mentioned, the Indian one I have mentioned, in England, in Sea Angel case, let me read the modern approach of frustration as the UK courts have put it. In my judgment, the application of the doctrine of frustration requires a multifactorial approach. Among the factors which have to be considered are one, the terms of the contract, two, its matrix or context, three, the party's knowledge, four, expectations, five, assumptions, six, contemplations, in particular as to risk, as at the time of the contract at any rate, and then finally, the nature of the supervening event. I'm sorry, and there's one more. The party's reasonable and objectively ascertainable calculations as to the possibilities of future performance in the new circumstance. I must pause here for a moment to say this, everybody, that you can't possibly say that anybody had contemplated such a kind of epidemic. I don't think that any of us in the world contemplated that such a situation would come, that we would be left at the mercy of a virus which would put and make a standstill to all kind of economic obligations, economic activities, and in fact ensure that contracts can't be carried out. So there is indeed, in fact, a very big need to review this entire subject to see how to do, and I'll come to a little point later on this. Coming back to the English judgment, since the subject matter of the doctrine of frustration is contract, and the contracts are about the allocation of risk, and since the allocation and assumption of risk is not simply a matter of express or implied provision, but may also depend on less easily defined matters such as the contemplation of the parties, the application of the doctrine can often be a difficult one. In such circumstances, the test, the final test, the test of radically different is possible, important. It tells us that the doctrine is not to be lightly invoked, that mere incidence of expense or delay or onerousness is not sufficient, that there has to be as if there were a break in identity between the contract as provided for and contemplated and its performance in the new circumstances. Now, let me just tell you what Energy Watchdog does and how it deals with this. This is a 2017 judgment, as I mentioned, of My Lord Justice Pinaki Chandra Ghosh and Justice Rohinton Fali Narima. It's a rather interesting case because there was a provision in the contract. exclusively for a non-escalable fuel supply issue, coal in particular. In this case, the tariff for the sale of power was to be determined through a competitive bidding process as per the electricity regulatory laws, which was undertaken. In the competitive bidding process, bidders had the flexibility to choose escalable or non-escalable tariff, that is, tariff based on an increase in tariff formula. Both Adani and Tata quoted a non-escalable tariff. This is because the only major component was the increase in fuel, which was the issue, in particular the coal price. Since Adani and Tata had long-term fuel supply agreements from coal mines in Indonesia at fixed and predictable prices, I suppose I can only say this, that they were confident that there was no need to factor in this price escalation. Accordingly, the lowest tariff was arrived and power producers began to sell power after executing PPAs, power purchase agreements. In 2-3 years, however, things changed. There was a massive jolt to the power producers because new regulations were passed by the Indonesian government. The net result of it was that the coal price started to be benchmarked with the international prices instead of the existing prices. This meant drastic increase in coal price, making it the tariff very unviable. As I mentioned to you, there was a non-escalable tariff within the contemplation of the contract. In a summary of the judgment, if I may, it's a lengthy judgment, the citation being 2017, volume 14, SCC, page 80. The Supreme Court says, the doctrine of frustration is inapplicable to the present case, as the fundamental basis of the PPA remains unaltered. The PPA nowhere states that coal is to be procured only from Indonesia at a particular price, and the fuel supply agreement is only a part of the PPA to establish that fuel supply is available and is in order. When the power producers quoted the tariff, they very well knew the existence of the risk of increased prices of Indonesian coal and knowingly took it by quoting a non-escalable tariff. However, mere fact that they quoted non-escalable tariff does not mean they'd be disentitled to raise a plea of frustration if they were otherwise entitled to under law. Force majeure clauses are to be narrowly construed. This is the other finding of the Supreme Court. Hindrance would mean an event wholly or partly preventing performance. So it cannot be construed in a wider circumference. It has to be a very narrow construction. Mere rise in prices is not hindrance in whole or part. Clause 12.4 specifically excluded rise in fuel cost or agreement becoming onerous to perform from the purview of force majeure. Since clause 12.4 specifically excluded rise in fuel cost from force majeure, since the fundamental base of the contract was never dislodged and alternative modes of performance were available, even though at a higher price, there was no force majeure. Further, since there was a specific clause addressing force majeure, section 56 did not have any application. There were some other arguments, but I don't want to really go there because the context of the present one is ultimately force majeure. And so in this context, the revised prices, because of the change in Indonesian law, did not give rise to a cause of action for pleading force majeure, or rather from succeeding in a claim of force majeure as far as the bidders were concerned. And the case was rejected of the claimants, which puts an end to this discussion of force majeure, bringing up the issue to the current point of time. I would like to, at this point, summarize some of the other events which I think are important in this context. Under the doctrine of frustration, impossibility of a party to perform its obligations is linked to occurrence of an event, circumstance, which is subsequent to the execution of a contract, two, not contemplated at the time of execution of the contract. Of course, you have situations where you identify within the contract, as I mentioned to you. The third point which has been made in the judgments, that the entire subject matter underlying rationale for the contract should be destroyed, which renders the contract void in the case of a frustration, and all contractual obligations of the party cease to exist. Frustration of a contract is a test that dehors contractual provisions and is the net result. On the other hand, the ones which are contemplated within the contract may result in deferment of performance of contractual obligations until the event continues, and typically does not absolutely excuse parties from performing their obligations. Now, the question arises in the current context. Under the Indian law, unlike the other jurisdictions, force majeure is a feature of the general law relating to contracts, and if the courts in India declare COVID-19 pandemic to be a force majeure event, then in all cases, whereas the facts and circumstances of each case so require, COVID-19 event could make the event and the performance impossible, attracting the provisions of Section 56 of the 1872 Act, and the performance could be excused. In unprecedented circumstances like the present, courts are likely to be generous in their interpretation of the present pandemic, as force majeure when faced with parties who have encountered genuine difficulties in performing. However, such parties will need to show that their non-performance or late performance was truly outside their control and could not have been prevented or mitigated. But even if the COVID-19 pandemic and related government action is to be treated as a force majeure event, the question then arises, what is the impact on the affected party's ability to perform its contractual obligations? If the impediment is such that it made it impossible, then there would be frustration and discharge the contract. But in other cases, where the pandemic does not strike out the performance, but only makes it a bit more onerous, the rights and obligations will be governed by the force majeure clauses incorporated in the contract, and the precise words of such clauses will be critical. A very brief rundown on the cases that have come before the courts in the recent past, where force majeure was attracted or at least at issue, and based upon that, some relief was granted by the courts. You have on 30th March 2020, where the Bombay High Court granted injunction against IDBI Trusteeship Services Limited from selling shares pledged by FCRP because of a share market collapse due to COVID-19. In Anant Raj, Delhi High Court held that Yes Bank should not have classified a loan as NPA, a non-performing asset, when delay in payment of installments was caused due to COVID-19. In Ideal Toll versus Infrastructure and Infrastructure versus ICICI, Bombay High Court restrained ICICI from alienating the shares pledged of MEP Infrastructure Developers Limited, that is the term loans extended to its subsidiary. In Standard Retail, Bombay High Court refused to grant exemption under the force majeure clause to steel importers as the activity was not hampered by the COVID-19. Similarly, you have just one more case, there are another seven, and I'll share a list with you people. In Ajay Kumar versus IIFL, Home Finance Limited, Delhi High Court allowed a family to reoccupy a floor of the property securitized by the Home Finance Limited under Section 14 of Surfaisi Act due to the extraordinary circumstances caused by nationwide lockdown. The impact, I told you I would not mention each of them, but there are similar kind of situations where moratoriums or NPA's declaration came into issue and some reliefs were granted, even of invocation of bank guarantee in Halliburton. But broadly, the impact of the pandemic is going to be different for different sectors. The infrastructure and development projects are of long durations, running into several years. Owing to suspension of work and transport restrictions, such projects may face delays and cost overruns. However, the force majeure clauses do cover for such contingencies, and the loss incurred will be dealt with according to the content of such clauses. Section 32 again. Force majeure clauses usually impose a duty on the party claiming to show that it has taken all reasonable endeavors to avoid or mitigate the event and its effects. This is a subjective standard and will be interpreted on a case-to-case basis. The circumstance must be the cause of the contractual breach, and a party claiming force majeure is typically required to establish that it was the force majeure event that caused the causal link, as we say. Recently, the Supreme Court also has invoked its plenary powers under Article 142 to extend the limitation period in all cases against the usual timelines under the Limitation Act. I think with the severity of the pandemic beyond doubt, the impact which the lockdown protocols are going to have on infrastructure and development projects is anybody's guess. The months after the lockdown period will see slow growth, and as things will crawl back to normal, disputes relating to infra projects will require swift resolution, either by courts or by arbitrators. Although there are indications that the government is going to adopt a liberal approach, and any disruptions directly attributable to the COVID-19 related events shall be covered under the force majeure clauses, yet I think it is prudent for the parties to reassess and review the contracts in order to analyze and quantify the impact of the COVID-19 situation, explore alternative methods of performance, and adapt the contracts accordingly in the view of the least avoiding unnecessary litigation costs. I guess, as I said to you, new jurisprudence will evolve charting out the doctrine of force majeure in situations such as COVID-19 and similar calamities. And we will have to factor in each of the considerations of force majeure, whether within the contract or within Section 56 of the Contract Act, to contemplate to what extent the same can cover, to what extent we should renegotiate. We as an any party should renegotiate the contract, because ultimately renegotiation is a very welcome effort, particularly considering the long-term projects. The causal effect is going to be a very, very major issue of debate in the courts as to how directly is COVID-19 responsible for seeing that the contract itself cannot be performed if it could not have been performed. Delay, onerousness, impossibility, radically different. I think these are the hallmarks of tests that are to be adopted while considering this approach, and we will be well within ourselves to actually look into these issues and to evolve a line of thought which you could utilize towards the practice of this issue when coming up with the real life. But the last statement I would like to make on the issue, not only of force majeure in commercial contracts, is that as far as COVID-19 is concerned, I think, of course, so much damage has been done to the globe and to the country. I do think that while we should factor in COVID-19 in issues of force majeure and contracts, yet at the same time, we must ensure that that the economic activities are not put to a standstill because of such considerations. So the tests have to be very, very alert, very vital, very conscious of the situations that are existing, and the causal effect and the consequent issue should be very, very important to determine as far as the courts are concerned, as for lawyers to address on these issues. And we should have a national responsibility on this aspect. Thank you.
Exposition of the law. We have got a lot of questions, as I can see from the comment section. A lot of people have a lot of questions, and I think that is the effect of your lecture, which has raised a lot of interest amongst the viewers. I'll be taking up few of the questions from the audience with your due permission, ma'am.
Yes, please.
So there's this question by Mr. Prakhar Mittal, as the name, they can read the name, is that whether the LIC or other insurance companies refuse to pay, when can they refuse to pay the LIC insurance cover if the insured dies during COVID-19
See, contract, as I said, contracts are based upon what is provided within the contracts. I remember when we had situations of earthquake, for example, there are some earthquakes in various parts of the country, and it's not been months, it's been more. The question was whether earthquakes by themselves would be covered. So the whole question, as I said, is twofold. One, whether such an eventuality was contemplated. If not a pandemic, any kind of disease issue was broadly covered. Two, whether act of God itself is something which could be contemplated within this if provided in the contract. Three, whether the contract itself provided for a general clause, which it normally does not. So really speaking, it would insurance is also a contract. It's a contract to secure and to insure the insured on the basis of the provisions provided for. So, for example, let me keep pandemic aside. Let's say earthquakes. If earthquakes was not provided for, an act of God was also not there, just in case that eventuality would cover, then obviously the insurance would not cover. On a lighter side, let me tell you another story. It was there in the papers 2 days or 3 days back, where a spouse killed the other spouse and claimed it was a COVID-19 death. And when the body was sent for postmortem, it was found it was not COVID-19. So COVID-19 cannot be the answer for everything. However, of course, in a genuine case, as I said, the whole question would depend upon the contract and the interpretation thereof. A contract cannot go beyond what is provided for, because these are also based upon actuarial calculations, and would find that situation in the LIC and the other insurance field.
Ma'am, there's another question by Mr. Abhinav Kumar, who's curious to know that if there is a television contract with the broadcaster regarding the broadcasting of a sports event, can a force majeure clause be invoked to cancel or to suspend or to terminate the contract? And though the date of performance of the contract is still, in the future?
The question is, what was the event contemplated? The event contemplated was the broadcast. Now, the broadcast could be of a current event or a future event. I assume that it might have been of a current event. If it's a future event, I don't see how any kind of question could arise as to invocation of force majeure. But let us presume for a moment, though Abhinav have not framed it as such, but if there was a current contract, a current event, which was to be broadcast at a later point of time, and that current event could not happen because of COVID-19, and therefore the question would arise. So again, it would depend upon the contract as to what the position might be on the first level, section 32, whether there was a provision of any kind of circumstances. That's why I said, what is very material is this act of God interpretation within a contract, which is very traditional in a lot of contracts, as well as the general saying that any other circumstance which has not been contemplated, if there is such a generic kind of provision, that would be within the contract itself. On the question of frustration, on a very broad circumference, if the event itself could not be held, which frankly at the current circumstances, all such events having been cancelled, for example, you don't have any activity of this nature. Why sporting any activity? Force majeure would be a very reasonable kind of plea to take in these circumstances.
Ma'am, there's another question from Sayesh Kamath. As to this is a question pertaining to two points. One is the NAFED case. The NAFED case, the Supreme Court talked about the self-induced frustration being included in the, you know, self-induced frustration being included in force majeure and can be read into the force majeure clause, whereas it is an exception to section 56. So do you think that was the proper interpretation of the force majeure clause? Can we bypass section 56 and self-induced frustration can be covered by force majeure?
Self-induced frustration can never be covered, because the whole contemplation of this is, it has the same kind of equity principle. A party cannot be take advantage of its own wrong, for sure. So, induced frustration can definitely not be a cause. That's why I was talking about the causal effect also. Causal. There has to be a direct cause of the, let's say, pandemic in this case of COVID-19 and the non-performance of the contract. If a party does something which results in the frustration of the contract, which is, of course, the self-induced part of it, obviously, there will be no question of invocation of this principle and to get any relief on that basis.
Okay. Ma'am, the other question is as to how do you contemplate, this is from Partha Sarathi Srivastava, as to how does one contemplate a pandemic? Should one ensure that they have an exhaustive, almost boilerplate-like clause mentioning all the possibilities?
Well, obviously, after seeing the COVID-19, and sometimes you hear of other calamities coming, I think when lawyers are advising clients or parties as to what kind of inclusion should be there in the contract, definitely there should be a wider ranging contemplation. If, of course, depending on the commercial, everything is also in a commercial kind of situation, all parties have to ultimately see to what extent the other party would go. But yes, logically and ideally, I think clauses today would need to contemplate a lot of calamities which were not earlier within our contemplation. And as I said, something like earthquakes, which possibly earlier one thought, at least even in India, these things didn't happen, should be something which is contemplated. Things like pandemics, like epidemics, we thought we'd got over them, but obviously we haven't.
Ma'am, can the government, because recently the government of India also came out with the notification as to what can be regarded, whether COVID-19, in which cases can be regarded as a force majeure. And so the question then is, this is one question which has been asked by gentleman called Soreen Thakkar, as to why did the government specify that it needs to be regarded as a force majeure, and why couldn't it be pleaded under 56 as a general case of frustration becoming impossible to perform the contract. The other question was that if there is a possibility of performance, but government has declared lockdown due to COVID-19, so what would it be regarded as? Would it be regarded as a force majeure or as a frustration, or the two different grounds at all, altogether?
See, if the government has allowed an activity, which activity could not be performed, or was not performed, definitely it could not come within the contemplation of force majeure. because the government had declared that it is possible. Now you choose not to do the same, unless and until it can be shown that as the whole test is radically different, or the contract is fundamentally changed. So each of these cases in contract, as you know, Lavi, you are the associate professor here. Basically, it's all on a case-to-case basis. So therefore, Absolutely. The positive again becomes an imperative. The extent of impossibility, the options of alternatives. So, you know, the Suez Canal case, for example, just because the Suez Canal was closed, it didn't become a situation where you could not supply from any other channel. Therefore, it could not become impossible. So it's difficult to give a catch-all answer to everything. You ultimately have to try to monitor what is there.
Okay. Absolutely, ma'am. Ma'am, the other thing which we in NUJS, SJ had a few questions. One was that if suppose, as was pointed out, that it cannot be, you know, it has to be a case-to-case basis decision. But let's say the government comes up with an order. Now, does it affect the burden of proof of the parties to the contract to establish that indeed they are covered by the situation envisaged in the order? Or does it kind of just, they have to quote the order and say that, you know, no, well, you know, it's force majeure and we are not performing the contract.
See, the government has not classified event as force majeure. It is only situations which have been there. So the situations have to be identified. So the burden of proof to some extent is alleviated. At the same time, it doesn't discharge. It's not the burden of proof. So you have to continue to prove each of the causal factors. And I think, I have identified most of them.
Yes, absolutely.
We need to go through those points to show that, you know, it is ultimately become frustrated. Absolutely, non-performance is something that has happened because of the issues in question.
The other thing, ma'am, is that if there is a, well, as is the case with the COVID-19 scenario, the question that is, can COVID-19 be used? Because this is a very specific question asked by one of our students, is that there are many rent agreements. And now the tenants are quoting the COVID-19 and they are saying it's force majeure. They will not pay the rent, but they're continuing to occupy the premises. So what do you think the landlords, what are the options available to the landlords? What are they going to
do? I think firstly, that's why possibly keeping this in mind, the general directives have been issued by the government to say that in cases where which are being occupied, where rent is payable or even for that matter salary is payable, the same will be paid. So it doesn't make it, in that sense, the obligation is one to continue to pay despite somebody not performing. It's a peculiar situation, though, I must say, in all fairness. And you will find most industries coming up with this. Some have already come up that they can't pay their salary to their workers, and people are finding it difficult because the owner or the operator in any manner, who himself is not earning anything because neither are the goods being produced nor is their functional, is unable to do so. But the question is, what is the fault in that sense of the other party? So the other party is available but is unable to come because of restrictions, let us say, of lockdown. So I think these are questions that have come up and will be addressed.
Ma'am, on a larger, on a long-term impact, as you yourself pointed it out in your lecture as well, how do you think the small businesses are going to deal with, considering their commercial obligations, their contractual obligations? What do you think is going to be the impact of this whole COVID-19 scenario and the legal regime on the small business?
I think the impact, as you rightly said, on people who have small trades or small businesses or small units or manufacturing units, they are the worst hit because they don't have the resources to be able to put the situation there. I think this is what calls for some kind of negotiation. I can tell you that in some situations, we have seen people who possibly cut some of the wages, if not entirely, if some part of it on a private basis, and this has been visible. The question is that there is liability to pay, but you can't pay because of the circumstances. So what do you do? Because you don't generate the income. So possibly some kind of renegotiation or some kind of discounting is something which everybody should think about.
Ma'am, there's this question from Alok Agarwal, and this is pertaining to invocation of bank guarantees. I think recently it was said that, you know, because of COVID-19, that, you know, bank guarantee, you know, they had put a stay on the invocation's bank guarantee. So, ma'am, how far do you think that's a feasible point, considering the bank guarantees are always held to be, you know, the courts shall not interfere, they will allow invocation. Do you think this falls in any of the categories of invocation?
Alok is very kindly given the ones which are against, but he's also given something which I'll read out to you for this question only.
Yes, sir.
Or irredeemable injustice.
Yes, sir.
So, of course, fraud is not the issue, but irredeemable injustice or special equities is something which can, and bank guarantees normally are something which secures performance. Now, the performance in a given case becomes impossible because of COVID-19, and there would be several situations. It is something, it's not a question of courts interference itself. It's a question of something which needs to be considered and will have to be considered. You will find a new line of judgments on bank guarantees.
Absolutely. Ma'am, there is this question, but the writer hasn't given the name. It's anonymous man, that's what I can see. But the question is, what is the legal position if a contractor chooses to invoke change in law for the purpose of claiming contractual remedies, since force majeure clause only excuses performance without payment of loss?
I'm not sure I understand this question too well. Maybe better put and we'll address it later.
Sure, ma'am. Ma'am, the other thing is, and this would be last of the few questions that there. This is by Kumar Gaurav. In the absence of a force majeure clause, can a party go ahead and enforce the contract if he is of the reasonable opinion that the counterparty is not affected by the pandemic?
As I mentioned to you, yes, because you have two provisions of force majeure. One within the contract and one outside the contract.
Outside the contract.
Always something which is available. The question is not of enforcing, but the question is somebody pleading, which is somebody which is always open to somebody to plead a supervening or a subsequent event, rather, which would make the contract frustrated and therefore the cause of action ceases.
So, ma'am, on a very, 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 very general and a larger perspective, since we all are grappling with the whole COVID-19 and its impact, ma'am, what do you think will be, I mean, how do you think can the contractual jurisprudence be affected by the impact of this COVID-19, post-COVID-19, what kind of scenarios do you think develop in the future in the enforcement of contract?
I think there will be tremendous development because you are contemplating a scenario which is uncontemplated. Let me put it in this kind of slang English, if I might. So you have not really contemplated this situation and the impact on various. For example, two of them you have mentioned right now, or your the people who question, let us say bank guarantees. Now, bank guarantees entirely developed field of law, but you have a situation which is force majeure, at least capable of force majeure construction. So, you will have a development of a complete field of thought. No work, no wages, yet government imperatives is yet another field. Non-occupation of premises, non-payment of rent could be another field. So you definitely will have a large development for the field of law in this.
So you think that the courts in India will be kind of looking into the whole force majeure, the performance of the contract, or maybe the breach of contract scenario whenever these cases come up? From a very different perspective, are we expecting a lot of jurisprudence coming in where we can develop our own scenario, which is kind of quite distinct from what is happening in the common law world in general? Or do you think we'll be getting more inspired by the English law precedent and
We by and large today, even though English law was very, very stringent, I must say, prior to the earlier days in the 19th century, so therefore a contract which had to be performed had to be performed. There was no exception to that. But that gradually shifted around, and that's why the Sea Lions case, which I read out to you, which essentially deals on a similar platform. You must remember that in that sense, the common law jurisprudence has developed on a common platform. So I won't say that there won't be any radical difference between the lines. I think we will be evolving definitely a set of common law jurisprudence on this within the country. And as I said, I think we can all work towards it by visualizing and identifying as to what are the kind of questions that might arise, because A, that will lead to help if there is any litigation, not if there is going to be litigation in future, and B, even more importantly, to advise regarding future contracts. Because one question is to deal with the current situation, and one is what future contingencies. Yeah. No, not only pandemics, but any kind of
situation. Any kind of situation.
And I tell you, it's even more important in the context of infrastructure contracts.
Right, right.
Contracts. These are not short-term contracts. You don't really want the patient. You don't want the contract to be discharged.
Absolutely.
You don't want the contract to exist. So nobody wants that. The idea would be to have literally a Section 32 contract basis to provide in the contract.
And
if you see contracts even today, you will find that, for example, escalation of price is something that is frequently contemplated within the provisions of the contract. So, how to do it is something which needs very, very quick evaluation.
Ma'am, would you like to take any more questions? I think
we've broadly covered. If there are any more, I'd be happy to take them across at some point and do them through mail. But I think we've covered the broad scenario. Yeah, so unless there is anything very, very different, I think it could be, I would to take it forward with. I've had a hearing in the morning.
I know, ma'am. Absolutely.
quite an experience. And I think, as I told you, we'll wind it up on this note to say that I'm very happy to engage with you and the institution. And Dr. Ayushi, who's there and who's led the whole thing there. Take this forward and to bring other issues. Hopefully in the next week or so, I will get back on the other projects that you and the students, because we need to engage ourselves. I'm very sure of this. And I really continue to do that process. And I think what we need to get out of this is the world is still not a dead place. And we need within this pandemic, rise from within the ashes, so to say. And connect ourselves into a different human.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving us your time, for sharing your experience, your wisdom, your thoughts with us. We've learned a lot, and I'm sure our students have also benefited a lot from this lecture. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a pleasure. The pleasure was all ours. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.